This is Barry Zalma, Zalma on Insurance. I'm an attorney who's retired from the practice of law and now spend my time as an insurance claims consultant, an expert witness, an author, and producer of these videos. Today, I'd like to talk about some ground that exists for a finding of the tort of bad faith. First, think of unexplained delays in communication. When an insured asks a question of his or her insurer, an answer is expected. An insurer should respond to all inquiries promptly and in no event later than 15 days. If an insured submits a proof of loss to which the insurer has agreed, and asks, when can I expect to be paid, the insurer should respond with specificity, immediately. Most policies and state regulations require payment to be delivered within 30 calendar days of the agreement to a proof of loss. If the question is ignored and payment is not made, after the insurer agreed to the proof of loss, the insurer is breaching the contract and of violating state regulations, and if without good cause, the covenant of good faith and fair dealing. Often, bad faith litigation is merely the difference between courtesy and a lack of courtesy, which is then interpreted to be an intentional wrongful act. An insurance company will not be allowed to deny coverage where all the relevant facts were known to the insurer at the outset, but it unreasonably delayed in asserting a basis for disclaimer of the claim. An unexplained delay of 2 months can be found to be unreasonable in disclaiming coverage. When an insurer waited an even longer amount of time, with an unexplained delay of approximately 1 year before mentioning two new reasons for refusing to pay, the court found the insurer's actions to be unreasonable as a matter of law. Consider Allstate versus Gross and Mendoza versus American County Insurance Company, two decisions of New York appellate courts from about 2005. An insurer's unexplained delay of more than 2 years in denying coverage was found to be unreasonable as a matter of law. Policyholders can also act slothfully. For example, in a case where there was almost a year of unexplained delay, plaintiff provided some of the necessary information, but still omitted a statement of facts and police reports. Thereafter, a general adjuster retained by the insurer fared little better. Although the plaintiff did not provide a written estimate of what it would cost to repair the damaged furniture, he still did not provide documentation needed by the insurer, and his delay was also found to be uncompensatable. Think of Levy versus Chubb, a 1997 decision of a New York appellate court. Then there are delayed requests for information. An insurance adjuster knows better than an insured what is needed to prove a claim, because most insureds have never had a claim before. If, for example, the adjuster fails to ask for a proof of loss, documentation to support a claim, or the sworn testimony of the insured at an examination under oath until months after the loss, the delay in the request can upset the insured and lead to charges of breach of contract and bad faith. Failure to demand the proof of loss within the time prescribed, when coupled with other acts calculated to lead the insured to believe that the proof of loss need not be furnished within the prescribed time, is sufficient to show an implied waiver in Georgia, among other states. The conduct of the insurer throughout the negotiations, if it shows conduct inconsistent with the contention that the insured failed to properly submit a proof of loss, can defeat that defense. Consider Knights of the Ku Klux Klan versus Fidelity and Deposit, a 1933 decision of the Georgia Court of Appeal. Sometimes an insurer will assign a claim investigation to an adjuster who does not have settlement authority. Because some insurers keep tight control of their adjusters, each level of management has limited authority to settle claims. If the person who meets with the insured has no authority or minimal authority and must work his way through multiple layers of bureaucracy in the insurance company, delays occur that will upset the insured inevitably. If the insurance adjuster has adequate authority to settle with the insured or claimant without delay, it will not evolve into a bad faith claim. In West Virginia, the Supreme Court, in a case called Shamblin versus Nationwide Mutual, a 1990 decision of the West Virginia Supreme Court, it was held that Nationwide Insurance Company did not act as a reasonable, prudent insurance company because it did not have an adjuster at trial with settlement authority or an adjuster with settlement authority available at the time necessary to talk to the plaintiff and plaintiff's counsel during trial. Settlement authority generally refers to an agent's ability to accept an offer of settlement that binds the principal up to and including a certain amount of money. A common misconception is that an insurer's loss reserves are the same as settlement authority. They are not. Reserves are just a guess, a educated guess of the exposure faced by the claim. The main purpose of a loss reserve is to comply with statutory requirements and to reflect as accurately as possible the insured's potential liability or the insurer's potential liability in a first-party claim. It does not automatically authorize a settlement at that figure. For example, when a trial court ordered the parties to attend mediation and required the presence of the representative of insurance carriers with full settlement authority, and explain that noncompliance with the order could result in sanctions, an unsuccessful mediation requested sanctions that were granted because the insurer's representative appeared only by telephone. This was Dollar Tree Stores versus Eights, an Alabama Court of Appeal decision from 2014. The failure of an insurer with potential coverage, including even an excess insurer, to have a representative attend court-ordered appellate mediation in person with full settlement authority will result in it being sanctioned by a California court for not complying with local rules, as would it happen if they failed to appear for any court anywhere. Now, it is really an issue of the tort of bad faith if the insurer refuses to pay a claim when liability is clear. If the insurer refuses to pay a claim because it disliked the insured and thought but could not prove that he or she is a criminal, the insurer was found to have breached the covenant of good faith and fair dealing. There is no reason, once liability becomes clear under the policy, to refuse to pay a claim. An insurer's actions that deviated from the standard of care for a reasonable insurance carrier in a similar position with clear liability, reasonable liability, clear coverage, an offer to settle, and a failure to achieve the settlement was within the reasonable expectation of an insurance professional handling the claim in the state of Florida for any other carrier in a similar situation. This was Balanowski versus Geico, a 2019 decision of a Florida court. Delays in settlement that damaged the insured's goodwill is also a potential for a decision that an insurer acted unfairly and in good faith, and that a tort of bad faith cause of action could be maintained. The covenant of good faith and fair dealing is implied in every insurance contract. The duty of good faith is breached where the insurer holds up payment of undisputed claims pending resolution of disputed claims. The insurer should understand, when handling a claim by a business person, that a business has more to do than resolve an insurance claim. The insurer should not deal with the minutiae of the claim process if it is detrimental to the business of the insured. The failure of an insurer to settle the claims of an insured's customers while waiting to settle with the insured, two separate parts of a policy's coverage, did not consider the damage it caused its insured's goodwill. As a result, although what it did was technically correct under the policy, the insurer found it paying bad faith damages to its insured, equal to many times the claims of the customers and the business the insured lost. Good faith claims handling requires consideration of the insured's rights and obligations, even if it means handling claims creatively rather than strictly following the policy wording. Delay alone will rarely serve as a sole basis for a lack of good faith claim, because a finding of a lack of good faith rests on a totality of the circumstances, and an insurer's procrastination without more might rarely be egregious enough for a jury to find a lack of good faith. Where the defendant insurer failed to respond to plaintiff's letter within 60 days, as mandated by state statute, the insurer's delay can serve as the sole basis for a lack of good faith claim, because its delay did extend beyond the statutory period. Consider Berry versus Nationwide, a 2018 decision of the U.S. District Court for the District of Maryland. Refusal to pay a claim where coverage is in dispute can still be considered grounds for a tort of bad faith claim. Therefore, an insurer must carefully consider all facts as they relate to the policy language and the applicable law before it decides to deny a claim. For example, when a passenger was injured in an automobile because a gun with a hair trigger discharged when the vehicle hit a bump, The insurer needed to consider that two policies of insurance may cover the loss, the auto liability policy and a homeowner's policy. The homeowner's policy excluded coverage for losses that occur in an automobile, and the automobile policy excluded coverage for losses resulting from acts not involved in the operation or use of an automobile. The two insurers could both refuse to defend or indemnify the insured. One or both, if it did so, could be liable under their contracts of insurance. And in fact, both were. And as a result, when the two insurers found themselves in a situation where one of the two may provide coverage, but for the existence of the other must be careful to protect the rights of the insured. If both deny coverage, the insured who paid for protection will have nothing. Both will be sued for breach of their respective contracts and for bad faith. When two insurers are faced with such a situation, they should never leave the insured with no coverage, but should enter into an agreement to protect the insured and agree to work out which insurer is obligated to pay defense costs and indemnity in a later action for declaratory release or in a binding arbitration, thereby protecting the insured and resolving the problem later between them. This is State Farm Mutual versus Partridge, a 1973 decision of the California Supreme Court, which found that both insurers were obligated to defend and indemnify the insured. This video was adapted from my book, Zalma on Insurance Claims, Part 106, Second Edition, which is available as both a paperback and as a Kindle book, and is part of the 10-part treatise, Zalma on Insurance Claims. If you found this video to be useful or interesting to you and your colleagues, please pass it on. It's free. And please also subscribe to my YouTube channel, my Rumble channel, and my blog so that you can be advised of future videos and future blog postings. Thank you for your attention.